Welcome to our third and final session of the first day of International Access to Justice Online Forum that's been convened by Victoria Law Foundation and the University of California Irvine's Law School's Civil Justice Research Initiative. Thank you for joining us for this session entitled Making Administrative Data Smarter. Hope you've enjoyed the sessions so far today. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional custodians of country wherever you may be joining us today. And I recognise their abiding connection to the land, its waterways and communities. The Office of Victoria Law Foundation and my personal residence sit on Wurundjeri land, and I pay my respect to their elders and to all generations of Wurundjeri and other First Nations people and elders joining us today. I thank them for their custodianship, and now I acknowledge that the lands that I am on were never ceded. Just some housekeeping issues or a reminder for those who have been with us already today or those who are joining us just now for this session. Only panelists can see and be heard in this webinar. All attendees' videos are turned off and their audio is muted. We ask that you please use the Q&A function to ask questions and also to upvote other questions. We'll have time to get to some questions later in the session. The session is being recorded and it will be distributed after the event. My name is Hugh McDonald. I'm the Principal Researcher at Victoria Law Foundation. It's my pleasure to facilitate this session and to introduce our wonderful speakers. Delphine Bellerose is a Senior Researcher at the Law and Justice Foundation of New South Wales. Natalie Byrom is the Director of Research at the Legal Education Foundation in the United Kingdom. And Dalié, Jiménez is Professor of Law at University of California, Irvine's School of Law. You can find further biographical information on each of our speakers in the program, and I urge you to have a look at that. The session today will have a series of short presentations from each speaker, then we'll have a panel discussion, and then there'll be some time to move to some audience questions. Please pop those questions into the Q&A as you think of them. That allows other people to see your questions and to upvote them if they so choose. We live in an age of unprecedented, ever-growing data. We've all heard about big data and how it can be tapped for new insights using things like artificial intelligence and machine learning. Administrative data is one form of big data, and the justice system produces a lot of it. Every speaker at the forum so far today has made some reference to data, to measurement, to monitoring, statistics, and evidence-based approaches in one way or another. We've also heard about the need to iterate, to learn what works, to improve access to justice, to experiment, test, improve, test again, and data's key to all of that. Administrative data is just simply information that's collected and stored as part of the everyday functions of organisations. As the name implies, it's primarily administrative in both nature and purpose. It's the information organisations need to plan, to operate, to manage, to monitor, to evaluate the things they do. A common use of administrative data is to count and report activities and outputs. Because the justice system produces a lot of administrative data, well, surely it must hold valuable insights. For researchers in particular, administrative data certainly has some advantages. Compared to data collected for specific research purposes, administrative data is relatively cheap and easy to obtain when justice institutions will share it. But administrative data also has disadvantages, given it's primarily collected and used for functional reasons rather than for research and learning reasons. It can be inconsistent, it can be incomplete, It might not record exactly what's needed or what people are interested in. A substantial effort may be required to clean, to reconfigure, to repurpose administrative data, to increase its utility, its validity, its reliability, and how it can be used and what insights it may hold. Recent global attention has called for greater efforts to improve the utility of justice system data, particularly civil justice data. The World Justice Project and OECD and others have made the case for improving justice data as a key strategy to progress equal access to justice for all. Priorities include improving data to better understand the scope, the nature, the impact of justice problems, to design and deliver effective justice strategies. As we heard this morning, some of that may be through technology. The call is to improve data, to measure what works, to learn, to adapt, and ultimately to improve. So it's the iteration and the improvement that, you know, we've heard about already today, that is what makes data smarter or potentially more useful. So the capacity to learn, adapt, improve, make data more useful, to build an evidence and knowledge base, and to learn more about what's happening, what's not happening, and when we try to improve things, what's working, what's not. And administrative data can and undoubtedly contribute new insights to build the justice evidence base, but only where the measures and quality of that data that we need, only where it has measures of the right measures and the right quality of measures. Certainly in the last 20 years of empirical legal research, we've seen a shift to people-centered understanding of access to justice and legal needs. Legal need surveys and other empirical research demonstrates inequality of legal and related needs, of access to and use of the justice system, and of outcomes. We need to shift to people-centered justice to further, sorry, we need to shift to people-centered justice data to continue that learning. Access to justice is really just about people, problems, and places. So we need to be able to see what the justice system does or doesn't do for different people, different problems, and in different places. In Australia, we've seen successive access to justice inquiries, reviews, and reports recommending improved justice system data to help assess community access to justice, to assess the performance of key justice institutions, and to evaluate policy and reforms. We have the technology, we have the skills, yet we still face data challenges. So can justice system administrative data be made smarter, more useful? Does it hold more insights and learning? Can it be used to learn more about the problems people face and the services they use or don't use and the difference that they make? So what works to improve access to justice across the whole community? Data is undoubtedly part of that narrative and story. That brings us to the first of our presentations this morning. The first speaker we'll hear from is Delphine.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Before I start, I would like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the lands we are all joining in from today. In my case, I'm calling in from Darug country, and I would like to pay my respect to elders, past, present, and emerging. I'm just going to share my screen. Okay. Now, most of you may be familiar with the work we do at the Law and Justice Foundation of New South Wales. For those who don't, we are a research organisation and we have a long history of working with court administrative data, mostly civil court, but also a little bit of criminal court. legal assistance sector service data, and that's probably where most of the experience I'm going to draw on today, but also census data and obviously other research, targeted research project and quantitative information. So what can we do to make administrative data or service data more useful? That's the question Hugh asked me when he first invited me to participate on this panel. I had to think about that. And I think the first thing that really came to me was, well, first we need to use the data. Now I realize that probably sounds like I'm stating the obvious, but just stay with me on that one. Too often in my experience have I come across organizations, people who tell me, yes, we do collect information, but no, we don't, you know, it's not good enough. We don't think it's reliable. We don't really want to use it. We shouldn't look at it. And that's a big issue. We really need to use the data. And by using the data, I don't mean do the analysis, come up with a number, jump to a conclusion and make a policy decision. That's not what I mean. I mean, we need to start looking at it more closely. As soon as we look at it, well, a few things happen. First, we identify where the issues are. And pretty much straight away, we can identify also what I call the quick fixes, you know, things to improve the quality. And it could be as simple as realizing that there is a default value or default setting in the database that might generate incorrect information when we extract the data at the end. Little things like that. It also helps everyone to realize the scope and the limitations of service data. And perhaps more importantly, it generates more interest, especially for people who are collecting this information and reporting this information. I think it's very important. It's critical that they see that this information is being used. And straight away, when we look at the data, we've already taken the first step to make the data more of a better quality. And that's the second point I want to make. Obviously, with better quality data, we have better chances of having more useful insights. What is quality data? As a researcher, I will say the data is of better quality when it is accurate, complete, and consistent. That doesn't mean it has to be perfect. In all the years, my years of working with data, I have yet to come across such a data set. And we've done lots of analysis and we can find plenty of very useful information and insights from data sets that are far from being perfect. I'm not going to dwell more on this because I think we might have more time later on, but I do want to expand a bit more on the consistent aspect because I think it's especially relevant to the topic this morning. As Hugh said before, administrative data or service data is very much operational in purpose. It records an organization's activity. If an organization delivers services, the chances are the service data is used to count how many services are being delivered. When we start using this data to answer much broader, more complex research question, policy question around access to justice, a few challenges arise. It implies pulling data from a number of different entities and putting them together. And the consistency then is really an issue. I'll briefly mention what I call the usual suspects, things that many of us in the audience have come across. And that is the different system, the databases that uses different format and don't speak to each other. The different terminology, using different terms for the same thing or the reverse, using the same term to describe different things, which is potentially more dangerous, I guess, because it kind of gives the illusion that data may be comparable when in fact it might not be. And going further on that, I think it brings up a kind of a deeper issue around the unit of measure that we look at when we put together service data from different organizations. What I mean is, what happens when a service, for example, a legal advice provided to a particular client for a particular legal issue, is not equivalent to another legal advice provided to another client for a different problem or in different circumstances? Or if you like, what can we do when in the data one service, one does not equal to one. How do we unpack those challenges? Now, as you might have gathered from what I just said before, the key here is usually to collect more information. It's not enough to know that there is one service. We need to understand what sort of service, where was it delivered, how was it delivered, what are the characteristics of the client, what was the legal problem or problems, and probably a lot more information around external factors. So essentially, we need more information to help answer broader, more complex questions around access to justice and better understand the barriers to accessing justice. Now, obviously, collecting more information means increasing the burden of data collection. If there is anyone in the audience who carries this burden of collecting data and reporting data, I bet you're nodding right now or cursing or both, possibly. And that takes me to the next slide, which is, what can we do to really pay more attention to the trying to strike the right balance between the burden of data collection and reporting versus the benefits we gain from service data? And there are ways to reduce the burden and maximize the benefits. There are a few things we can do to help try to help reducing the burden of data collection. I think the first thing we need to look at is data systems. Again, in my experience, I've often seen that the increase in the burden of data collection is not so much because of trying to collect more information. It's often more to do with trying to work around the limitations of the systems currently being used. And that often implies duplication of the work, trying to come up with some parallel system, something paper-based, something more manual, more tedious, that really increases the burden of the collection and the reporting of that information. Another thing that's important to look at is obviously the training and how to build data capability within those organizations collecting the information. A lot of service providers out there are coming up with very innovative resources to try to provide ongoing training around the data collection and reporting. At the end of the day, good data comes at a cost, and it requires adequate resourcing. I wrap this up because I think I'm about to run out of time, but I wrap this up with a couple of thoughts on how can we maximize the benefits of service data. I think service data, and it's not just in the legal sector and not just in Australia, I've come across that issue in different fields as well. I think service data generally suffers from a history of having been used largely as a monitoring tool, as a performance indicator to account for money, generally for funding. Now, I'm not saying that public money should be spent and with no accountability. That's not what I'm trying to say. But too often, when we look at service data, there is a lot of focus on the precise number and what might happen if that number goes up or down. And these are really, valid concerns. They need to be recognized. And I think there's a need to try to shift the conversation beyond just performance monitoring for funders. And I'll finish up on one last thought is it is very important to share findings from service data and or make the data more accessible. And I know Julian in the previous session, in the previous webinar, said something about, in the legal sector, there's too much reluctance with sharing data and using evidence. And I think I really agree with that. In making data more accessible, we really allow for this information to be used alongside other data sets and to be used alongside in view of other research findings from targeted research projects or any other research that comes up. And that really, when we kind of start putting all those pieces together, if you like, that's really when we build a stronger, more robust picture of access to justice and the barriers of access to justice and what really happens in the current landscape of addressing demand for addressing legal needs and demand for services. And when I say making data more accessible, it's not just to make it more useful for researchers. I think ultimately it's really making it more useful for the sector themselves, for people delivering those frontline services, how to make the data work harder for them by sharing it, opening the discussion and making it more accessible. And I'll stop on that thought. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Delphine. Up next is Natalie. Natalie has gone well and above beyond the call of duty to join us today. I believe it's well past midnight. It's about, 20 past one in the morning. And I think that is a clear data point that gives an indicator of her interest and passion for data and data issues. So over to you, Natalie.
Thank you so much, Hugh, and it's such a pleasure to be with you this evening. And I want to extend my enormous thanks to Nigel, to you, Hugh, and to Tanyelle for organising such a brilliant event. So as Hugh stated in my introduction, my name is Dr. Natalie Byrom, and I'm Director of Research at the Legal Education Foundation and Director of our Justice Lab initiative. So the Legal Education Foundation is an independent charitable trust and that awards grants totaling between £5 and £7 million a year to organisations who work across the UK to advance access to justice. Today, I wanted to talk a bit about the initiative that I lead on, Justice Lab, and some of the work we've invested in to improve the quality of and access to data about the justice system that's held by government. We also have a programme of work led by my brilliant colleague, Tracy Guyton, looking at the data that's held by community organisations. I also want to touch on what we're learning about what it takes to build smarter data and why we're so committed to this work. So the Justice Lab represents a £10 million commitment over 10 years on the part of the Legal Education Foundation. It's conceived as a strategic investment in the infrastructure, the capacity, the skills and the resources needed to transform the evidence base around access to justice. And the initiative aims to empower the access to justice sector to confidently articulate and evidence the difference that their services make in communities across the UK, and to support organisations to understand what's working and to improve the transparency and effectiveness of the justice system. So the Justice Lab has four key objectives: to improve the quality and availability of data about the justice system, to increase the volume of robust quantitative research linking services to impact, to increase capacity in the research community to design and deliver robust research, and to improve uptake of evidence in the design and operation of the justice system and the delivery of services. So to achieve these objectives, we advocate for and invest in approaches to improve the ability of government agencies and frontline organisations to gather and use data, and we conduct, commission and catalyse research, evaluation and analysis. So, turning to the topic of today's panel, I wanted to quickly share with you some of the challenges and issues around government-held administrative data in the justice space in England and Wales. So firstly, I think it's fair to say that we are operating in a context of historic underinvestment in data collection, in data management and data governance. We've got poorly codified practices, no catalogues, a lack of data standards, and many of our government services and systems are undermined by a reliance on legacy case management systems. We're also operating in an environment of missing data. So the Centre for Public Data, a think tank that does amazing work in the UK, did some analysis of written questions submitted in Parliament during the pandemic. And what that found was 40% of the quantitative written questions that were asked of our Ministry of Justice could not be answered because the department does not hold the data. And I want to be very clear on this. We're not talking about like advanced data. For example, the ministry held no data on how many judges sat during COVID, how many remote hearings took place, or what happened to disabled people and other marginalized groups during this period. I think it's also really important because many of the challenges around data are actually cultural challenges. to mention that some of the cultural challenges we face. Justice data is tricky to define and talk about. There's an absence of language for making the case for why bad administrative data matters. Law isn't a quantitative discipline in this country, and in the context of cuts to legal aid, prisons, et cetera, it's never the top of anyone's wish list. So what have we done and what are we learning? Well, the foundation had an opportunity to really lean into this work that was created by the ongoing £1 billion programme of digital court reform. This was initiated in 2016 and was designed to create end-to-end online systems and radically overhaul existing legacy case management systems. So the digital reform programme provided the opportunity and the infrastructure to radically rethink the way in which data about the justice system is collected, stored and shared. The foundation's interest in improving the way data is collected and managed by the courts and tribunals led to my secondment to government to define the data that new digitised services should collect and recommend reforms to existing information flows, including those relating to judgments and case law, and propose new governance models to support data sharing both across and beyond government. So in order to support this work, we invested in legal advice to address challenges and barriers to collecting data. So at one point, we were told that data protection legislation and government digital service standards precluded the collection of demographic data about court users. We had to go and instruct counsel to provide legal opinion to demonstrate that this wasn't the case. We've also really kind of put our money where our mouth is. We've invested in the creation of data governance mechanisms within government to try and improve the way data is managed and to enhance researchers' access to it. The recommendations that were developed through my secondment to the government were published in our 2019 Digital Justice Report. In 2020, the government responded, accepting the majority of the recommendations that we made, but progress on implementation has to date been varied, and much actually will depend on the outcome of the spending review allocation process, which is due to conclude imminently. With this in mind, our focus has shifted to advocacy. We're increasingly working with think tanks and investigative journalists to gather the human stories that explain why this lack of data matters and make the case for investment. We partnered with the Bureau of Investigative Journalism, which is a not-for-profit agency advancing public interest journalism, to gather the data that government had failed to collect on the impact of COVID-19 on eviction proceedings in the housing court, which showed, and this project really showed, that despite promises that government had made at the start of the pandemic, that no one would lose their home as a result of COVID-19, and investment in measures that were meant to empower judges to take COVID into account in decisions, pregnant women, families, people who'd been affected by the pandemic were being made homeless. So I guess I wanted to conclude with explaining why we're so committed to this work. Well, obviously, improving administrative data is key to designing and delivering better research, whether that's about identifying representative samples of people to interview or whatever else you want to do. And this is what initially drove the foundation's interest in this work. But the longer we've looked at the problem, the more we've realised that this goes much deeper. It's also about fairness, it's about transparency, it's about inclusivity, and it's about accountability. Without data, we are flying blind. We are wasting money, designing poorly evidenced policies, and letting court users, court staff, victims, witnesses, and the public down in the process. Some of the questions we can't answer include, like, which is more effective at reducing case backlogs, remote hearings or Nightingale courts? We just don't know. There's no data on it. What have COVID-19 arrangements done to case outcomes? Again, we don't know. There's no data on it. There's been a focus in the UK in the media on reports that domestic abusers are using allegations of parental alienation to encourage courts to remove their partner's access to their children, effectively weaponizing the family justice system against victims of domestic violence. How often does this happen? How many parents and children are affected? Again, we don't know. Choosing to continue as we are is the equivalent of starting a new hospital and choosing not to record how many operating theatres it has, how many surgeons are available, or how many patients die. It's an act of gross negligence. data is key to building a fairer, more inclusive justice system. I think it's really important to remember that data is a representation of power relations. What we collect dictates what people care about. And at a basic level, if you are not counted, you don't count. Women, disabled people, people from global majority backgrounds are missing from the data held and by the court system in England and Wales. And because of this, their voices, needs and experience are missing from policy conversations. We talk a really good game in England and Wales about our justice system being the envy of the world, the best and the fairest. Now we need to prove it. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Natalie. Brings us to our final presentation in this session. Before we take some questions, and just a gentle reminder, if anyone does have some questions, to pop them in the chat. So Dalié, we're excited to hear from you now.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm Dalié Jiménez, and I'm here in Irvine, California, on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Achachaman and Tongva people. And I want to respectfully honor and recognize the original and current caretakers of this land, water, and air, and all of their ancestors and descendants, past, present, and future. It is an honor to be here. And thank you, Hugh, and everyone for organizing such a great event. And for all of the previous speakers who had some really excellent points, especially Natalie, I think it's great that I'm following you because you made a lot of the points I was going to make, and I'll just make mine using examples of, your last few statements about data. I would rephrase as data is political, data gathering is political. And there is, and as you said, it is a representation of power relations. And I don't know, I've been doing this for enough time, and maybe I'm jaded, that I think you can sometimes, you can never prove, but it does seem to work out really well that the information that, certain people in power would not want to be known or to be difficult to find is the one that what we had difficulty finding or identifying or describing in a sort of, complete way. So I'll step back for a second. I study consumer financial distress in the United States, and I rely heavily on empirical methods. For the last 10 years, it is actually almost to the day 10 years, I've been working on a randomized controlled trial studying people in financial distress. First, the study was going to be in Delaware. Then we got kicked out of Delaware, basically. The court basically said we could not run our study there. Then it was going to be in Maine. And we had to leave Maine because of their data, essentially the way that they held their data, and they could not give us address information for individuals quickly enough for us to actually be able to field the study because we needed to contact people. Eventually, now the study is in Connecticut. And we've stopped. We're now just in the last phase of survey collection, and it's longitudinal, so we're following people for some period of time. The idea is to merge administrative data, court record data, with survey data from the individuals, as well as attorney, summarized attorney representation data, and credit bureau data, other kinds of private administrative data. There were a million, as I already described, a few problems we ran into this political point. What we were trying to gather is information about debt collection cases, primarily, and who sued, who wins, who's represented, who isn't, do the outcomes change when somebody is represented versus when they're not. We were run out of Delaware because in that case, this is now over 10 years ago, all sides, both the consumer and the debtor, the creditor bar, agreed that they did not want a study in Delaware. They did not want a light shown on the procedures and what the outcomes, et cetera, there. So other issues we ran into, eventually we got courts to agree. We were able to gather data, but then of course you have issues like, the court system changes their record keeping system. And so now some data that was gathered because of a particular system that was created, a computer system, and now it's a slightly different system. So some of those data points are no longer gathered. They actually regressed in our experience. They were gathering very, it was very easy in the previous system to get at information like what was the average amount demanded from someone in a debt collection proceeding. Did they win? What was the average amount awarded? It went from a system in which you had a field for that to a system in which you have to dig through, documents that have been scanned that are not easily machine readable to figure those things out. And even sometimes those documents are, missing. So you learn these things, you see these things happen, and some of it, part of the answer is, the system is not meant for studying. Obviously, it's meant for whatever the people who are running it think is important. Go back to the data is political point. What is important is not just about what they think is important. It's also about what people who they're representing think is important, or it should be anyway. So data is political is my, really my overarching point, but I'll just give one sort of, and that's, it can be very, an uphill battle in the United States. It's a battle that you have to fight on many fronts, because we have, and this is probably similar in other places, but we have 50 states. Each state has, multiple levels of courts. So if you're trying to study a problem like debt collection, that can happen. Actually, there can be debt collection lawsuits in different levels of courts. And so you have multiple courts and with different procedures. And it's always just really important, to remember, obviously, that the different procedures really can affect both what happens, but also how it's recorded, what is recorded, and the same words in one place and another place, with default means in one place versus another place, are not necessarily the same thing on the ground, which then leads me to my other point that, how do we make administrative data smarter? At one level, we do it through, I think, the political process. That doesn't necessarily mean elections or anything like that. I just mean, really trying to, really trying to convince either gently or not gently the people who gather the data, who keep track of the data, that they should gather data that researchers are interested in, or data that can really count people, as Natalie said. I've had multiple conversations with both sort of IT people and court, judges and chief justices, et cetera, about things like, why aren't we keeping track of, race and gender? And Natalie alluded to an issue where some, I don't know who it was exactly, but making the argument that it was some data privacy law that meant that you couldn't do that. We have so much sort of private information, if you were, sensitive information people would be upset if it was available to the public, which it is, but if it was like easily available to the public, that's already at court records, for example. But knowing how that information outcomes vary, across race, gender, disability level, that would be really important. Of course, researchers, we try to do all sorts of proxies for that, or all sorts of ways to try to essentially fix that problem and try to still figure out the larger questions. But none of those are great. They're all approximations. And they're always subject to the, well, you did that wrong, and therefore your answer, your study shows something that isn't really what's happening. It's because you don't have perfect information. And that's sort of the, a larger criticism often about that you don't have perfect information. You only have information in one court system or three court systems, but there's 50 of them, et cetera, which, is a larger sort of problem with empirical work when you have so many different pieces. So the last part, the how do we fix that, or one way anyway, it's not the only way, but is that once we have done, we researchers have gathered data, and taking the time to understand it, to understand particular systems, whether it's a court system, or I also work with credit reporting data, as I mentioned, from a large credit bureau in the United States, which is a really massive data set. And trying to merge that with state level administrative data is a major undertaking. And that major undertaking should not be done by a small group of researchers. It's my view that it should be something that's open to other researchers, even ones from non-elite institutions, even ones who don't have sort of the massive amounts of funding, which frankly is the reason why our first study took so long to even get started. We needed like $2 million to get it started, which was a lot at the time I was a junior researcher. So there are multiple attempts to do this here in the US. The Pew Charitable Trust Foundation is leading they've been funding small collections of debt collection data across the US. And eventually the goal is to put them all together in a repository where certified researchers can get access to them. And it's not just the data, the raw data obtained from courts, it's the documentation, it's the aim to build such documentation from researchers of explaining, what does this really mean here, of normalizing data to the extent possible. We have a current undertaking of, trying to explain in this state during this period of time, or in this court, default means this, in this other place it means that, so that you can actually make nuanced decisions or analyses based on that data. Another example is the California Policy Lab, which is a sort of UC, University of California entity that is trying to do this for administrative data here in California. The way they built the system is inherently collaborative. There's sort of a wiki type platform where all the researchers who are working on something are supposed to and are asked, encouraged, but also sort of required to enter documentation to any changes they make to the data set, to share their code, to share their identification strategies for various things that are not obviously in the data, but something that somebody would want. So we're doing work on student loans here in the US, and one of the perennial problems when you're looking at credit data about student loans is, what is a private loan? What is a federal loan? There have been a few places that have identification strategies for that, and they don't share them. But our aim is to bring in as many people as we can possibly bring in to look at that, at the data, and to have common understandings. And to be able to share those understandings and discuss them. I think I'm out of time, so I'm going to stop there, and I look forward to the questions.
Thanks very much, Darlene. I think the real value of forums such as this is the opportunity to speak and hear with people from around the world and just get a sense of just how familiar and how shared a number of these experiences are, which I think just naturally reiterates and points to the need to be sharing those experiences, insights, learning, and the tremendous opportunities for collaboration and coordination of effort. But moving on to the discussion, what I think I'll do is I'll sort of merge some of the questions that I had with some of the questions that are coming through in the chat. And one that we've got is definitely shared interest in these issues of data quality. So we've heard in our discussion so far, the data quality is important, but we can probably never be in a position to stop to strive for that perfect data set, and that perfection is the enemy of use and innovation. But how does data quality affect its utility, and where do you see sort of the limits sitting, and what sort of safeguards do we need to think about, and what might be put in place so that we can be reasonably confident that when we use data, we're not going beyond its quality. Does anyone want to jump in on that?
Yeah, I'm happy to, Hugh. I think, there's something here, isn't there, about And this is why data catalogues and really being very clear about what the limitations of the data are so important. I think because I totally agree with what Delphine said, like how you drive up the quality is by getting people to use it to explore the data. So one of the things that we've invested in the UK, our research councils have funded a new initiative called Administrative Data Research UK. And what they're trying to, and there's a particular project, the Data First project, which is being developed in the context of MOJ. And what they're doing is looking at putting key data sets from legacy case management systems, which are messy, incomplete, missing, into a secure research service, which has really strict controls on how the data can be used. And what that's doing is it's giving the opportunity for researchers to explore the data that's there to really begin to map like the biases and the risks and the limitations, and then publish kind of descriptive analysis on that data. So you actually get to learn about how it can be used, but under really strict conditions. I think when you're thinking about outside government data that's held by community organizations, my brilliant colleague Tracy is doing a lot of work around how can you, I think this starts with, we're working with a lot of organizations who are understandably quite nervous about using data. So there's something here about how can you help organizations to work with what they have to provoke kind of curiosity about what that data could be used for. And then once you've kind of provoked that curiosity, it's then working with those organizations in quite an intensive way to support them with the kind of skills, the systems that are needed to really kind of iterate and enhance. In terms of one of the things that government's developed recently is obviously we have statutory standards for national statistics, but you're increasingly seeing departments release management information that's carefully kind of caveated. And I do think that's really important because putting the data out there, and to be clear, this is all like anonymized management information. But I think it's really, it's just being really clear about what the strengths and limitations are and being very clear about what uses this data can reasonably be put to and what it shouldn't be used for.
Jumping in, just to add to that, I think really transparency is key here as to what data is being used and to do what with. You know, if a decision is being made based on a particular set of data, that needs to be clear and how the data was collected, and again how to acknowledge the limitations of that data is really important. And I think there's also the challenge is how many intermediaries do we have between the people actually delivering the services frontline and collecting the information and having so much expertise in terms of what they do and, you know, and what happens and how they address, you know, the client coming through the door and their problems. And if they collect the information, but then that information might be reported to different organizations, and that's escalated to other organizations and other organizations. So there's kind of a lost in translation kind of process by the time decisions can be made. And I think this is particularly tricky and challenging. So it's important that the people collecting this information and with the expertise also understand, also look at how the data is being used, and that transparency and that conversation really flows, you know, across all those processes and those intermediaries. I think that's really key.
Thanks. I guess a related issue is data standards, particularly say within a jurisdiction where you've got multiple different institutions. Certainly from a research point of view, we can sort of think of a dream ideal state where sort of definitions are aligned, where there's sort of common views and definitions of certain features as you've all been mentioning. Is the sort of the challenge within sort of a national level, or I can imagine a supranational level, of trying to move towards sort of common data standards, which have elements of quality. Is that realistic in the short term, do you think? Or is that something that goes in the too hard basket until we each get our own houses in order? Because I can certainly imagine a situation where one place or one area is doing fantastic data work, another place is doing fantastic data work, but they're fundamentally not able to communicate because they're using different standards or different definitions. Do you think that's one element we need to think about tackling?
Absolutely. I do think it's a very long-term thing, but it is something, you know, for future sort of, and it's also something that is not going to help us with, you know, past data. So that's, you know, it sort of diminishes its priority to me, in the sense that we're always going to have, you know, historical, even if, you know, even across one jurisdiction, historical abnormalities that we'll want to know about and keep track of. So I think, I mean, I mentioned this Pew project trying to, you know, get a normalized understanding of where are the apples that you can compare to other apples in different jurisdictions. And I'm not sure you can do that across everything. Or across, you know, every question or across every data point that you're interested in. But perhaps I'm talking about, you know, across many jurisdictions in one country or multiple countries, we can do it at some, you know, broad or top level data, it's top level view. And then we have to sort of get deeper. I mean, I think at some level, if we think about this as, you know, how is this data created? It's because of actions of people. And at the court level, at least in the US, judges just, you know, they are, and we have examples of cases where they're given a sort of standardized system and then they create their own variables because they will not be, you know, kept down by that. And then every judge has their own variables. And so there's now thousands of variables just for their own, whatever little code that they like. So I don't know how I think that's a human, element and a system thing that I'm not sure is ever solvable, but it is important to know it's there and to know that we have to understand it before we can really, you know, use that data for something, you know, critical or important.
I think it's really interesting. I agree with all of that. So data standards in the justice space, I think the work needs to take place at a hyper-local level, certainly in England and Wales at the moment, because it's one of the huge issues. One of the, to give just one example, the government has a stated priority to tackle serious sexual violence against women. The police and the courts, there is no standard definition of the variables that together, or the offence codes that together comprise that. So anytime a minister stands up in parliament and says this has gone up or this has gone down, it's not based on anything. I think that is absolutely where we need to be working towards. It's really interesting. The government's published a national data strategy, which for the first time has really sort of highlighted that data standards are key infrastructure. And increasingly, as we become a more data-driven economy, they are the foundations on which everything else is built. But how you go about implementing that, I mean, it's about shifting culture in the way that Dalié spoke, like you can't have people going and inventing their own cult. And so I think people talk about data as though this kind of, it's this abstract clinical thing, when really what you find the more you try and work with it is that it's actually about culture. It's about shifting practice. It's about all of those other things that, you know, Dalié's presentation really highlighted. And so whilst I'm optimistic that, yeah, that should be the goal, I think this is not a cost neutral exercise, and there's a lot of work that would need to go into it, starting at the local regional level before we even got to like national and international standards.
In Australia, yeah, we have a new national data strategy as well. So it's something that's clearly coming into vogue. I think another sort of thing that goes hand in hand with data standards that, you know, and I'm going to argue against myself now, as we keep changing standards, we keep changing practices and measures, which gets away from baseline understanding, baseline data. As Dalié mentioned, we potentially start undermining a historical perspective on data. So I guess that's another set of challenges in this sort of Gordian knot that we have to deal with. But I'm interested in, like, because we've got a few minutes left now, I'm interested in trying to end on a positive note about the potential of administrative data and the classic administrative data that is in held by courts or legal assistance services or other parts of the justice system, civil justice system. Can anyone share, or do you have any sort of real basic insights that you've got that have sort of increased understanding just from sort of what we might describe as sort of mundane, basic administrative data, that as researchers, when you've been able to see that, have there been any eye-opening things that you can share?
Hugely. So the Family Justice Observatory, which is an initiative funded by the Nuffield Foundation in the UK, and they supported, to a tune of a couple of million pounds, the linking of data from CAFCAS, which is the Children and Families, so basically it's an agency that supports families who are going through contact cases, to pull that data with data that's held by the SAIL data bank, which has population level records for every person in Wales. And what that revealed is really basic stuff that we didn't, but things that we just completely didn't know about the characteristics of families going through private law proceedings. They were actually tended to be much poorer than people thought, which was really, really interesting. They've also done some amazing work looking at the rates of and outcomes for newborn babies taken into care, which really has the opportunity to really kind of influence policy in a really effective way. So I think that's really exciting. At the not-for-profit level, the charity Safe Lives has worked across a network of domestic violence advocates organizations to really create a data standard and a system for sharing and pooling data. And what that enables those organizations to access is kind of national trends in domestic violence, issue spotting, all of those things, and also to make the case to government for why it's important that those services are funded in an ongoing way. So I really do believe that, you know, if we get this right, it could be transformational. I know Dalié's put in the chat some examples that she'd like to share, so I'll shut up now.
Yes, if I can add to that, I agree, there are plenty of examples where service data has been used or administrative data has been used to the benefits of the community. At the Law and Justice Foundation of New South Wales, a few years ago, some of my colleagues did an extensive piece of work looking at the civil court's administrative data, and they found that a large number of claims were about the local councils making claims for unpaid council rates. And most often for very relatively small amounts of money, you know, under $2,000. And they realized kind of the cost of you know, the legal proceedings was sometimes really more than the cost of the claim itself. And that informed a review of financial hardship processes, and that really kind of brought to light something. So that was really to the direct benefit of the community. Financial, you know, local councils were then had to review how they look at financial hardship requests. And that's, I think, a very key example. In a different field, and there are lots of them, but in a different field, I guess, many, many years ago, I used to work in the drug treatment field, access to drug treatment. So we're looking at that service data for people accessing treatment for problem drug use. And we use that information, and the analysis of service data really showed an increase in problem drug use in relation to benzodiazepines, and that directly informed, again, that was picked up by other organizations and directly informed a review of prescribing guidelines for some of those drugs. And so again, it directly impacted, positively the community at large. So I think, and there are lots and lots of examples I'm sure we can use.
Well, unfortunately, that's taken us to time, so it falls to me to wrap up. On behalf of the speakers, I'd like to thank you all for attending this session. And I'm sure all the attendees join me in thanking our speakers and for their presentations this morning. I mean, I think for many, data is seen as being a very dry topic. Administrative data even more so. But I think the session today and the forum overall really illustrates how data and data issues are bound up with fundamental access to justice issues, how we understand access to justice, and the wider social and political context in which those issues come to the fore, are debated, are acted upon or not acted upon. So data is, fundamental to understanding what's happening and on what scope. Beyond bigger data, I think we need smarter data. So it's been wonderful to have this opportunity for this discussion today. On day two of the forum tomorrow, we have sessions on legal need, empowerment and older people. A session on culturally appropriate service design and delivery, and a session on the courts and COVID-19, and I guess the experiences of the courts, and I think it may go towards some of the digital transformation issues. You can find links to those sessions in your program and in the forum emails. That information is also available on the Victoria Law Foundation website. And finally, good afternoon, good evening, good morning, go well, and have a wonderful rest of the day.